Okay, in this video, we're going to start to learn about the fundamental theorem of calculus. Now, the fundamental theorem of calculus is about three different quantities and how they're all related. The first of these quantities is a definite integral. That's, the total amount of stuff described by a function f between a and b. So, if f of x is the height of a curve, this integral is the area under the curve between a and b. If it's a velocity, it's a distance traveled between a and b. It's a total amount of stuff. An indefinite integral is like a definite integral, only now x is the variable at the top. It's how much stuff is there between a and x. The third quantity is an antiderivative, a function whose derivative is f of x. Now, the fundamental theorem of calculus has two parts. One part relates definite integrals to antiderivatives. It says if you can find an antiderivative to a function, you can compute an integral. This is by far the fastest and easiest way to compute definite integrals. The second part of the fundamental theorem of calculus relates indefinite integrals to antiderivatives. It tells you that it is about what the derivative of an indefinite integral is. Okay, so let's look at these three quantities, and then in the next videos, we're going to get the different parts of the fundamental theorem. So our first quantity is the definite integral. So here we have a curve, and we want to ask, what is the total area under the curve between a and b? And our procedure for doing that is take the region and we chop it up into a whole bunch of little pieces. And this idea doesn't just work for areas, it could work for volumes, it can work for distances. Any bulk quantity you write as a sum of pieces, and then you say the total area is the sum of the area of each piece. And then you say, well, what's the area of each piece? Well, the width of each piece we call delta x. And then we have to figure out what the height of each piece is. Well, we could take this height, or we could take this height. We pick some point in the middle. Let's call it x1 star. And we say the area of this piece is f of x1 star times delta x. So it's the height times the width. And then you get f of x2 star times delta x, where this is x2 star, and so on. And so by definition, the definite integral is the limit, as you chop things up into more and more pieces, of the sum over all of the pieces of the value of the function at a particular point times the width of that piece. Now that sounds like a mess. You can do it by hand for some really simple functions like x or x squared, but doing this procedure for a general function can be really, really hard. Now, one thing to note about the definite integral is if I ask you what's the integral from a to b of f of s ds, that would be the exact same thing. All we would be doing is we would be saying, you know what, instead of calling this x, let's call it s. And so, instead of calling the points x1 and x2 and x3 and so on, we'd call them s1 and s2. So whether you call it f of s ds, or f of t dt, or f of x dx, it's all the same thing. Okay. The next quantity is the indefinite integral. Now for the indefinite integral, we're thinking of the total amount of stuff as a function of x. So let's say that this is 1, this is 2, this is 3. F of 1 is going to be all of the area between a and 1. So that's f of 1. It's not the height of the curve, it's the total area. F of 2 is all of the area up between a and 2. F of 3, sorry, not f, call this I. Call the function I of x is going to be the area between is the integral from a to x of f of s ds. So that's our indefinite integral. This is the indefinite integral. The definite integral is from a particular spot to a particular spot, from A to B. The indefinite integral is where we think of it as a function of the endpoint. The bigger x is, the more area we get. The last concept is the idea of an antiderivative. Remember, we're not calling antiderivatives integrals. They're antiderivatives. And an antiderivative of little f of x is just a function whose derivative is little f of x. Now, we often speak of the antiderivative, but that's a little bit of a misnomer. What's the antiderivative of 3x squared? Well, it could be x cubed, because the derivative of x cubed is 3x squared. It could also be x cubed plus 7, because the derivative of that is also 3x squared. So there's actually a lot of different antiderivatives to a function, but they all differ by a constant. Really, the antiderivative of 3x squared is x cubed plus an arbitrary constant. Usually when we say the antiderivative, we really mean a particular antiderivative. Pick your favorite one. Okay? So those are the three concepts, and next time we'll see how they're related.